Thank you for that very nice introduction. Thank you, Mr. Biju. Thank you, Haripriya. And usually I'm on the other side many a times. Day before yesterday, I was interviewing Kochi Tharoor in our platform regarding students and youth reach out programs. It's always a good feeling to talk. Basically, I know a person who studied philosophy, who has keen interest in philosophy. I think it will be more of a mutual sharing session. We can share the insights we have learned. Yeah, maybe how much ever technology grows, maybe these are all a reminder for us that people-to-people contact and human-to-human contact are extremely important. And that's also a definite way forward. Digital world is extremely important because we are all going to have digital identities. We are all going to have a digital life. But at the same point of time, nothing in the world can replace person-to-person contact, direct body language, and so many other things. Anyway, it's always a privilege to come here. To speak about emotional intelligence, which is a topic which is very dear to me. And if we can, I'll just have a short presentation in the beginning. I have tried to make it as less academical as possible. But having said that, this particular concept has profound psychological depth and philosophical foundations. So we can't escape at least some part of it when we discuss this whole concept of emotional intelligence. When our parents were working or when our grandparents were working, the core idea of the world was that people need to have IQ or intelligence quotient. When we were studying in the school, all the teachers used to ask how smart the kids are or is he intelligent. We might have in all Indian languages, whether it be Hindi, Tamil, Telugu, Malayalam, or Kannada, or North Indian or Northeast languages, we have all heard stories of intelligence or what we call buddhi shakti or what we call understanding, grasping power versus raw power of the man. So we have all been accustomed to the idea of IQ for, say, perhaps many centuries altogether. For many centuries, people used to believe that a person's success, person's well-being, his achievement, his sense of life, his sense of everything in the life is connected intimately to an idea called IQ, which is variously called his intelligence, his understanding, his wisdom, his knowledge. So many other things combined we used to call it. 1990s, if we can have the first change of slide, it would be nice. If the person who is listening to it, yeah. So the whole thing changed when a person called Daniel Goleman appeared on the horizon. Even though Daniel Goleman is not the person who started this concept, he was working for the New York Times. And back in 1990s, perhaps most of us may have been in school at that point of time, or many might be, about to go to school or maybe just toddlers. Daniel Goleman, picking up from the earlier concepts of many psychologists, evolved an idea or rather popularized it in layman's parlance to an idea of EI, emotional intelligence or emotional quotient. Right now, looking back, we don't understand the path breaking or the paradigm shift that Daniel Goleman made, because Daniel Goleman really changed the way we saw ourselves, really changed the way whole understanding, school, curriculum, so many things appeared. Many psychologists were reluctant at first to accept Daniel Goleman saying that there is nothing called emotional intelligence. No, we in the word emotional intelligence in the conventional term, many a times he's called character, his personality, he deals with things well, his attitude towards life. These are the different terms we use for the beautiful idea of emotional intelligence. But Daniel Goleman wanted to make it more scientific, more tangible, more measurable, so that even the academicians, the scientists, the layman can understand. And Daniel Goleman pointed out through various studies, and please remember, these are not folklore wisdom. These are not common sense. These are not ideas that people give from their hat, or these are not conventional wisdom. These are the areas of empirical research, years of painstaking data analysis, understanding, experimentation. And Daniel Goleman pointed out that a person's going up in life, his altitude in life, his career, his growth, his upward movement, everything is designed by something called, or everything is more influenced by, to put it more right, everything is more influenced by something called emotional quotient rather than IQ. There are various proportions and statistics people say regarding EQ and IQ. Some people say it is twice as important as IQ. Some people say EQ is 75%, IQ is 25%. I mean, we have very little scientific sanctity to any kind of those numbers. But having said that, almost all the psychologists world over accepts in the past 25 years that some kind of EQ and emotional intelligence is more important than IQ. So that comes to a very critical question. What do we mean by emotional intelligence? We all know what IQ is. IQ is when we do all those logical problems, the mathematical problems, the beautiful linguistic problems, all those things, you know, we might have practice for CAT, we might have practice for so many other exams. But what is IQ? IQ, and please remember, IQ, by and large, even though it is not 100% fixed, by and large, it's a gift of the nature, it's a gift of the genes, it's many a times it's the gift of the nature and nature you are being born with. But nurture or environment or EQ is something you can amass, you can take for a very large extent. There are many people who explains emotional intelligence in such simple terms. That's the reason why I have not taken a very academic definition of emotional intelligence, but rather a very normally understandable to all kind of a definition. Emotional intelligence is the capacity to be aware of, control, express one emotions, and to handle interpersonal relationships judiciously and emphatically. This is emotional intelligence in a nutshell. The capacity to be aware of, control, and express one's emotions and to handle interpersonal relationships judiciously and emphatically. And in short, we can tell EQ is more important than IQ. What are the five main tabs, five main yardsticks, or five main breakdowns of what we generally call emotion quotient? The first thing is self-awareness. What is self-awareness? You are all right now listening to something, maybe seeing something, computer, maybe using mobile. You are all have aware of your circumstances. You might have your own personal things to deal with. Somebody may be happy, somebody may be sad, somebody may be thinking, let me listen to this seminar first for a few minutes and then go to some other place, let me do something. You are all having multiple thoughts, emotions, so many things in your mind. Self-awareness means you are aware of what you are. You are aware of the strengths, weaknesses. You are aware of the emotions and thought processes inside. But we don't let our emotions rule us. We don't let our emotions overwhelm us. That's self-awareness in short. Being aware of yourself. Self-awareness is a very spiritual, if I can use that word, concept too, in all the Eastern esoteric traditions. Starting from Zen Buddhism to Indian philosophy, awareness, mindfulness. Right now, all the corporate companies even have huge seminars on mindfulness and awareness. So self-awareness is the first step or the first particular pattern of Daniel Goleman's emotional intelligence. The second thing is self-regulation. Many people are aware of their emotions, but they are overwhelmed by it. They are run over by it. The ability to control emotion, the better word, especially Daniel Goleman and his era may have used that word. In the past 10 years, even though the word control is used, a better word which is used is channelize. The ability to control emotion and channelize emotion. And one very important thing is the ability to delay gratification. In the history of psychology, some of the most prominent experiments have been done on the study of delaying gratification, which many might find it very interesting. And the marshmallow experiment, in common terms, you can say some kids having chocolates or some kids having Cadbury's kind of an experiment. So what the researchers did was they took a control group of, say, 10 students on one room, 10 students on the 10 students on a different room, and they were observing and understanding from the students. And many students were told not to touch the chocolate until those experimenters or those subject matter experts come back. And if they can control their urge to have a chocolate, they will get more because of the, as a reward of controlling their desire, as a reward of channelizing their desire. And interestingly, the people who did the marshmallow experiment found out those people, especially those young babies who were able to delay their gratification quotient, able to delay their gratification and immediate urge to fulfill their desires, earned more in life, secured higher positions, higher grade, achieved more heights in life because there is a better self-regulation. We cannot be at the mercy of our own self. We cannot be at the mercy of the emotions or physical or mental attributes of we have. They are all good. They are all to be celebrated. At the same point of time, we cannot get defeated by them is the core idea of self-regulation. So you are able to regulate, you are able to channelize, you are able to delay the gratification for a much favorable, positive thing in future. And in simple word, we can say just discipline. Self-regulation is more of a technical word. And discipline, unfortunately, in Indian education system and the education system world over, discipline is considered a bad word. Discipline is considered something too monotonous, too bad, too wrong, something like military stuff. But discipline is a form of self-love. Discipline is being able to do those things which your mind says, let us not do it. When you are tired, your mind says you are reluctant, you are lazy, you are cozy, you are so many other things, you don't want to do it. But you know it is important to do. That's what discipline, I mean, a higher form of discipline we are saying. It can also be called a finding rhythm with yourself, finding harmony with yourself. On a higher stage of discipline and finding harmony with yourself, you usually call that word form. People who are familiar with cricket might be telling. Cricket might be knowing this particular terminology, Sachin or Virat Kohli, you know, they are class players, but today he is out of form, out of touch, out of form, not in the zone kind of experience. So self-regulation is when you can channelize yourself, you can go beyond yourself through that proper channelization using discipline, using ability to control, uplift, inspire yourself. These are the major yardsticks for self-regulation. And some aspects of self-awareness, regulation, motivation, empathy may all be overlapping because they are very subjective terms. See, psychology emerges from philosophy. Psychology and sociology are the youngest daughters of the great mother tree of philosophy. So some terms may be overlapping, some psychologists may have used it different, but I'm just pointing out the general concepts and general ideas. The third is motivation or inspiration. Maybe in our land, the word motivation, because of so many motivational speakers, has a wrong connotation and a wrong meaning. But inspiration or motivation, the positive sense, is the ability to energize yourself, ability to inspire yourself, love challenges, being productive at times of adversity. Everyone knows that a car needs fuel to go on. In the same way, a human being also needs fuel, energy kind of things to go on. You may derive this energy from love, being a workaholic, that's not good, but still being a workaholic, or maybe from entertainment, maybe from cricket, maybe from sexuality, maybe from spirituality, maybe from playing with children, maybe from so many other things. That kind of positive energy. When I use the word positive energy, I don't mean any spiritual or religious connotation. Positive energy is a very much misunderstood word. Energy is only those kind of emotion that gives you a momentum to move on, go on, achieve further, work further. So when you have that energy, it is something like filling petrol in your tank so that you can move on for more. So from self-awareness, self-regulation, motivation, empathy. Empathy is extremely important in the modern world. It is very easy to say about empathy, but very tough to understand and implement it. Empathy is the ability to push away our judgmental self and have more understanding of others. How much ever empathy you have, we will still have a 10% or 20% judgmental self in us. We may be showing or expressing empathy, but deep down, there is an analyzing, judging person for sure. See, nobody can remove it, but we only need to have an upper hand for empathy, a real understanding of what the other person is, trying to get into his shoes or her shoes, understanding, wearing their cat or hat or cap or understanding that. So empathy is less of judging and more of understanding of others. And in that understanding, you have great people skills, which is the fourth one. And that is, the fifth one, the social skills, the people skills, the win-win attitude you have, and the ability to communicate well. So if you can go through, forgive me for the numbers, self-awareness, self-regulation, motivation, empathy, social skills, are the key components of what we call emotional intelligence. Next slide, please. I'm sorry that I couldn't change my slide, and Mr. Biju really helped me with it. Thank you for that, Biju. And IQ and EQ, as we said, if we just go through the history, whenever we study philosophy or psychology or positive psychology or humanistic psychology or self-learning or self-realization and understanding, it's always nice to learn a bit history about it. For the only reason, even though it is academic, we can know on top of which all gems we are standing, which all great ideas we are standing. The ideas of EQ or emotional intelligence are not new. Even 2,500 years back in the ancient Greece, in ancient India, in ancient China, ancient Egyptian philosophies or religions or psychologies, they always had this idea. Even though they didn't use the word psychology, they had their own notions regarding life. In China, it was Confucius and Tao. In Greece, it was the Athenians, the Socratic philosophers, so many others. And maybe the earliest notion of what we call emotional intelligence can be seen in the ancient Greek philosophy when they said, you are not affected by incidents. You are affected by how your mind interprets it. I'll repeat, we are not affected by events or incidents. We are affected by how we interpret, how we understand, and how we explain those things to ourselves. That's a very important concept in life. Explaining things to others can be tough, but explaining it right to ourselves is always a tricky thing. So interpretation, understanding, mental paradigm, these are all things we'll definitely look. So this concept in the modern parlance emerged, as we earlier said, in the 1990s. It was the Yale University's very famous Peter Salovey and John Mayer, who didn't imagine emotional intelligence to be such a popular concept, but they developed it earlier in the late 80s and 90s. Then Daniel Goleman, as we told, took it as a path-breaking idea, which is even right now discussed 2020 in India, his concept when he was conceiving it many thousand miles ago in New York or in US. And Harvard Business Review termed emotional intelligence as the most groundbreaking, paradigm-shattering idea in the past decade. So that much was the importance. All the important CEOs, mid-level managers, corporate employees, schools, educational curriculums, teachers, to a great extent, even companies, even nations think about this. That's the reason why even UAE as a nation, United Arab Emirates, is having a happiness ministry. There are many nations in the world, especially in the past 10 years, are seriously beginning to invest in the mental health and mental well-being and the psychological well-being of their people. Happiness Ministry is one such example. Happiness Index is one such example. All things point out to the importance of inner life of a person. Earlier in Indian context, the best leaders were those leaders who built the maximum number of roads or maximum number of institutions. Yes, infrastructure is extremely important. Nobody is denying so. At the same point of time, in the past many years, you might have seen a lot of inner technologies emerging, a lot of understanding emerging, yoga emerging, Tai Chi emerging, so Zen emerging. So many other things are emerging even in the West for the simple reason it is extremely important for an individual to understand themselves. And human resource is one of the most important resource we have in the modern era. And all the studies have pointed out that the heights we achieve is more correlated to what we call emotional intelligence. Ideas, emotional well-being of a person, of a company, or a group. Now we are coming to our core. Overview or background of what is emotional intelligence as a theory, as a philosophy, as a psychological concept, and as an empirical understanding. Now, when we come specifically to the workplace, what are the things that we should definitely look at? I'll ask you all a question. You need not answer. You simply have to think about that in mind. What is the average lifetime of an individual? How long do we live? There might be different answers. Somebody will say it is 60, somebody will say it is 70 or 80. General, if he can take a normal average Indians, because we are all more Indians here, if he can take an average lifespan of an individual to be around 60 years. A 60 years is a 56 or 58 is the, according to the national average. But if we take that an average life and continue with us, 1/3 of our life, 1/3 of our entire life is we are spending on our work. That means if you are working, if you are living for almost 60 years, we are working for almost 20 years of our lifetime. Usually lifespan is divided into three. A day is around 24 hours. So 8 hours, according to our biology, we have to sleep for almost 8 hours. That means if you are living for 60 years, almost 20 years we are going to sleep. 20 years we are going to spend on our work. Almost 10 years we are going to spend, we are spending on our relationships, our personal relationship, our social relationships, all the clubs, all the other meetings we have, we are spending 10 years. And the rest 10 years we are spending for entertainment and the rest 5 years for routine. This is a normal average of how a normal person spends their life. Out of 60 years of lifetime, we sleep for 20 years, we work for 20 years, and we meet with people, have relations for 10 years, entertainment and routine for another 5 years. This is how we spent. So the longest, perhaps the most active, the most vibrant space and phase of our life, more than our families, is spent on work. In the earlier childhood, it is schools. You go to school from, say, 9:30 to 3:30. You go to college, you go to courses, then you come to work. So it is basically your career and education related. You are spending 20 years of your life. So it's a very important aspect that we create emotionally intelligent workplaces. Unless we have such emotionally intelligent workplaces, life at work affects life at large. Our life at work affects our life at large. Everything will be topsy-turvy when we don't have a sense of achievement, sense of well-being, sense of pride, when we don't have good emotional connectivity, when we don't have many things right on the working environment. That's the reason why, metaphorically and for the sake of rhymes, many people call all the organizations are like living beings or organisms. The reason being, there is a symbiotic relationships happening in companies. There is an organic relationship that is happening in companies. And we spend the quality 8 hours we have, or 9 hours for some companies, on the workspace. So it is extremely important that we create emotionally intelligent workplaces. And unless we have such emotionally intelligent workplaces, we won't be having happiness in life, peace of mind, harmony of activities, which are closely linked and interdependent on the work and the workplace. Now let us come to the landscape of emotional intelligence. Rather than the beautiful sounding theories, rather than understanding the great philosophies or what other people told about all these emotionally intelligent things, what are those things which we can do? What is the application in our real life? What should I do? I don't anyway, you know, 90% of you won't have to write an exam on emotional intelligence, won't have to take a seminar or session on emotional intelligence. So there is very little point in knowing the history, philosophy, psychology of emotional intelligence. But rather we should be knowing what all we should do regarding emotional intelligence in our work and in our daily life. And emotional intelligence is generally broken down into practical steps in almost 5 or 6. Many psychologists differ it from 5 to 10 ranges. But everyone understands that emotional intelligence, one of the first yardsticks, consists of 1, utilizing an assertive style of communication. See, communication is an extremely important aspect of our life. You might be wondering, the only thing we continuously do from the moment we are born to the moment we are no more, you know, we two great legends, two great people, actors are no more amidst us, the great Irfan Khan and the legendary Rishi Kapoor. So till the time we are over, from the time we are born, we breathe, we inhale oxygen, exhale carbon dioxide, and we also communicate in one way or the other. And utilizing assertive style of communication doesn't mean verbal words alone, doesn't mean the email or the technical emails we send in our organization. It also means being aware of non-verbal communication, being aware of tones, being aware of the implications of our speech. I think the particular PPT has come back, so I'll take it from them. Next slide, please. So being aware of nonverbal communication means there are many studies which suggest the importance of nonverbal communication in personal relationships and official relationships. Many of you might be surprised to know the great scientist who laid the framework and the foundations of modern nonverbal communication. It was none other than Charles Darwin. Charles Darwin, the father of evolution, who wrote a book, The Expressions of Emotions in Man and Animals, back in 1872, if my memory is not right, if my memory is not wrong. He spoke about nonverbal communication, and people like Alan Pease have pointed out the importance of body language in personal relationship, husband-wife relationship, colleague relationship, boss-subordinate relationship, and every relationship we have. And almost all, Albert Mehrabian is a communication scientist who pointed out that 7% of the communication is through words, 38% of the communication is through tones, and 55% of the communication is through body language. So this is very important aspect we have, utilizing an assertive style of communication. Assertive means you are not aggressive, you are not passive, you have found a golden middle path, like Buddha said, the optimum reaction. You are neither on a very aggressive, very raw, very crude, very rude, very on the face kind of communication. Neither you are passive, neither you are being submissive, neither you are sacrificing yourself. You know what you want, you know what the other person wants, and you are ready to use your assertive style in finding a consensus where you both can go ahead, where there is a win-win situation, utilizing assertive style of communication. Second, very important point, because life, another name of life, synonym for life, a different word for life is conflict. We go through conflicts almost every day. Conflict is in everyday life, may it be with the milkman in the home, which I had a problem with today morning because he was late, maybe with the office you have, maybe with the CEOs you have, maybe with the subordinates you have, maybe with every person in the world. Conflict is an inevitable part of our life. Conflict resolution is an important aspect of emotional intelligence. That's the reason why people use three words. One, you either don't respond, shut yourself, you know, disconnect, disengage yourself. That's a very wrong attitude. You either react to the other person. If they are giving fire, you return fire. If they are giving 10, you are giving 20 back, that kind of a reacting mode. That's again aggravating the conflict. What you do is respond instead of reacting to conflict. The third most important thing, active listening skills. Trust me, friends, when I say this, listening skills are tougher than communication skills. I mean, I won't say it is easy to speak, but it is comparatively tougher to listen than to speak, because listening involves an inner involvement, being attentive, being empathetic, being understanding, understanding a layer beneath what the other person says. That is extremely important. That listening is an extremely important skill. Unfortunately, that is not given much emphasis in our Indian education system, Indian curriculum, and public discourse. We all, I mean, I'm a participant of many news channels. I love all the news channels. I love all the people associated with. But you might have seen people listen less, talk more. You know, it is something like a cacophony or a symposium or seminar where people say a seminar is a place where everyone talks, no one listens, and later everyone disagrees with each other. I mean, all our debates, all our seminars, all our communications, unfortunately, don't have enough emphasis on listening skills. Listening skills means not hearing, an in-depth understanding, being attentive, being there, and listening with your heart and soul and mind. So active listening skills, be inspired, what Abdul Kalam calls, we should have a soul on fire. And the only thing that is unstoppable in the world is a soul on fire. That courage of conviction, that purpose, that inspiration is extremely important. So being inspired and fighting negativity with positivity. I'll come to this because this is the toughest thing in the whole lot. It is very easy to say this, but you know, it is very easy to hear all this gyan, but it is extremely tough to implement that in real life. I'll come to it in the end. And please remember, every criticism you get is a feedback. Only when you have a positive mentality towards criticism, you will not have animosity, hostility, or trying to prove the other person wrong or retaliate whenever a person is raising a negative comment about you, criticism about you. All those ability to take a criticism as a healthy feedback, as a learning, trust me, that will change our life in a great go. 3 or 4 days back, I was reading a news piece of Sachin Tendulkar, you know, who I really think is the god of cricket. Sachin Tendulkar, I think after the first innings, and he was giving an interview to ESPN or something, where Sachin, after the first innings against Pakistan, where he scored around a paltry sum of 20 or something, Sachin Tendulkar told the then coach or manager in charge, Ravi Shastri, that he doesn't believe. Sachin Tendulkar telling Ravi Shastri that, "I don't think I'm good enough to bat." See, if a person is thinking like that, if even Sachin can think like that, it is very natural for us to think also in the same lines. So it is very important whenever you are faced with failures, you take it as a learning experience. And this is not a consoling word. This is not some feel-good word or a feel-good thing of the Karan Johar movies. This is an actual reality of life. This is a factual reality of life, that when there is a paradigm shift in our thinking, the criticism is being taken as a learning experience or a feedback, and every failure adds to you. And this will really change our life in a very big way, that can really enhance so many things from us. So the attitude of learning is extremely important. It is not a fancy word. And please remember, the opposite of failure, we usually say it is learning in corporate parlance. The reason it is not a metaphor, it is not an indirect consolation, it is not a some kind of a prize or trophy given to the people who have failed. It is a genuine learning experience we can learn from. And the landscape of emotional intelligence also have empathy, approachability, and being sociable. These are other qualities which the word stands for themselves, being approachable, not having too much air, not having too much arrogance. The really good people, great people, are those people who don't realize that they have such goodness among them. They are naturally humble. You don't pretend to be humble. You are naturally humble because you understand what little do we know of this world, what a tiny speck you are in this whole vast universe. So a natural humility comes in, which will help us a lot in getting better interpersonal relationship. And the last one, which is extremely important in a digital age, in whichever sphere you see, whether it is digital media, social media, Facebook, politics, society, police, court, whichever area, every day we are faced with negativity. Maybe we are the generation which are experiencing the maximum negativity, or what you call in transactional analysis, negative strokes. Strokes only means unit of recognition, feelings you get, environmental stimulus you get. We are the generation that is experiencing the maximum negativity from society and people around us. It's a cutthroat competition, voila, environment. People are having trouble. So you will have negativity every day. You will learn to deal with negativity in a positive way. In mathematics, negativity versus negativity becomes positivity. That's only max, but that's not real life. But in real life, negativity, when met with positivity, becomes positivity. And I think the great fan of Gandhi, Mr. Martin Luther King, used to say, darkness cannot drive out darkness. It is only the light that can drive out darkness. It is something we learn from third standard or fourth standard. That has enormous implications in everyday life of us, whether we are dealing with anything, whether it is a complaint in our corporate companies, whether it is an escalation by a senior manager to your higher up, whether it is an escalation by colleague, whether somebody demeaning an idea you told, whether somebody giving you a disgusting look, whether somebody is giving you a kind of a stare, whether somebody is giving you any kind of negativity, which really decreases our energy. We all need energy to move ahead. And whenever we are faced with negativity, we really go down, we feel down, our mood is lost. So many things happen. It is important you have an inner mechanism where you can generate that positivity and inspiration for yourself. So I'll just run through the landscape of emotional intelligence once more. Utilize an assertive style of communication. Be aware about your nonverbal communication. Be aware about your tone. Because only 7% of communication is verbal. This is a study by Albert Mehrabian. There are different dimensions of the study. For the want of time, I'm not getting into it. 7% of communication is through words. 38% of communication is through tones. And 55% of the communication is through nonverbal communication or body language, which can cause deep fissures in our personal relationship. If it is a marital relationship, you are looking, girlfriend, boyfriend, husband, wife, or intimate family relationship, the single most destroying factor of interpersonal intimate relationship is the body language of disgust. Please remember this. There are many studies on this. Disgust is the single most damaging thing in our personal relationship, especially intimate relationship. Disrespect and negativity in professional relationship. So please use an assertive style of communication. Respond instead of reacting to a conflict. Active, sincere, honest listening skills. I believe whenever I take sessions, rather than I use the word active listening skills, I always use the word honest listening skills. Please remember, you cannot buy honesty. You cannot achieve honesty. Honesty has to come from within. And that honest listening skills is extremely important. Somebody beautifully once said, half of the problems of mankind can be solved by honest listening from a person. The other half can be solved by honest talking from a person. That means 100% of the problem we have can be really solved by honest listening and honest communication. Be inspired, fight negativity with positivity. Every criticism is a feedback, empathy, approachability, and being sociable. Next one, please. Next slide, please. I think we only have two or three slides. This is again a technical one, just to understand. You know, you might have all heard of the, right hemisphere and left hemisphere of the brain. Even though it is oversimplified in our corporate talks, it's a much more complex thing. Back in 1981, Roger Walcott Sperry won the Nobel Prize for his research on cerebral hemispheres. It's a reality. The left hemisphere of the brain and right hemisphere of the brain, there are difference in orientation. Even though it is exaggerated by our speakers for the sake of simplicity, the reality is that we have to be aware of our brain function, and we have to have a holistic thought, a comprehensive understanding, an intuitive understanding of the situation along with the left hemisphere of the brain analysis. I was just keeping it so that, you know, there is a neuroscience, maybe the next most important field. Right now, the corporates are using psychology. Maybe 10 years down the line, when our youngsters are 20 years down the line, when our kids are working in the corporates, there will be more neuroscience sessions there, because it will be a more objective empirical study. Next slide, please. So we are coming to Daniel Goleman's own word. He says, the interest in emotional intelligence in the workplace stems from the widespread recognition that the abilities of awareness, management, empathy, social skills separate the most successful workers and leaders from the average. This is especially true in the roles like professions and higher level executives, where everyone is about as smart as everyone else, and how people manage themselves, manage their relationship, gives the best and gives the edge to them. These are words by Goleman back in 2012. I am verbatim quoting him. Please remember, you know, this is not something I usually tell my students when I take in colleges or schools, that the technology we study in our educational institutions might not be of that cutting edge used to us once we are in the corporate. Every technology is changing per year. New technologies are emerging. You will all be working in a technology that has not, in 10 years, that has not actually been even discovered at this point of time. So an amount of adaptability, your ability to learn, is extremely crucial in these circumstances. So what is more important? Human relationships are more important. The good team skills you have is important. Please remember, we shouldn't have this relationship with an attitude of, see, I will gain some from this, I will manipulate some from this, but from an honest realization that this is the most important thing and crucial attribute or element of our life. You might have all read and heard about the Harvard University's grand study. Harvard University grand study is the longest running research in the history of mankind, which is going for the past almost 80 plus years. People like Kennedy, who later became the US president, was a part of the original Harvard grand study, which was commissioned in the earlier part of the last century. After researching for 80 years, the crucial aspect they have found is very important thing. The poets, the philosophers have used to tell it for so many years, but the scientists have found after empirical study of brain, questionnaires, psychological methods, understanding and analyzing people over many decades, what they have found is good human relationships protect even your brain. They have a healing effect. The better community bonded you are, the better you are bonded in your workplace, in your environment, you have a better chance with life. You live more, you have more healthy, you are more happy. So that personal relationship stems from an in-depth relationship with yourself. So having that relationship, or what we call interpersonal skills, is extremely crucial. Next one, please. Coming to the benefits. Please remember, we need to have EQ not for benefits, but for the sake of EQ itself. But having said that, there are many aspects of EQ that we need to remember. Definite better job performance, if you have a better EQ, can be there. Managing teams better, especially when you go higher up, what you need, especially all those people who are in the mid-level management or the high-level management who might be in this particular webinar will be knowing, the more important when you go higher up is the more people skills you need. You need to manage people, motivate people, understand people, empathize with people, have a patient listening with people, then only you will be able to move along and get going. Higher job satisfaction, and as in Kung Fu Panda, the famous movie, they say the most, that's a Zen thing. Zen is an ancient Buddhist or ancient Indian philosophical aspect where they say, when you have inner peace and inner clarity, you have almost everything else, because from that inner clarity and inner peace, everything else comes. Next slide, please. And now coming to real life examples of how you can and what you can do to enhance emotionally intelligent behavior in organization. One solid example is every day you find people who are not upbeat, who are upset. Sometimes they hide that they are being upset. Sometimes they don't say it out. Sometimes they don't articulate. So an upset employee finds a good listener is an example of an emotionally intelligent organization. An emotionally intelligent organization will never say, you know, it is a very wrong notion that we had. See, you had some issues earlier. Now forget about all that. Now you work. Can you seriously imagine what kind of productivity that person will be having? That doesn't mean we can solve each and every problem of every individual that is in our organization. That only means being empathetic, having a good listener, taking that person to confidence, that person's, uska man halka ho jayega. In Hindi we say, you know, uska dil halka ho jayega. He will be better off, he will be better cooling off, and he will be able to work well. So an upset employee finds a good listener, great. Second, listen and express. This is more often than not happening to male, especially introverted males. Whenever we study in companies, there are many, especially male men who are introverted, who falsely believe they have an air of superiority because they express less. See, we have been conditioned by this very wrong thought that if you are expressing enough, you are not a man. If you are conveying your softer side, you are not a man enough. That's an absolutely wrong notion. You will only be psychologically sick. Your pent up anger will in one way or the other burst and explode because you cannot hold on to yourself for long. So listen, but please remember you express it. And what is the benefit? You all, I will give you a very simple exercise. Think about a person in the past 1 month because of their behavior. Usually such kind of grudges happen when we meet people more. Say in the past 3 months, any person, because of their behavior, because of their disgusting tone, because of their anger or arrogance or putting you down or speaking you down or looking at you down, you felt a grudge. You felt some kind of a revenge. You felt, I will show him or show her the next time. I will retaliate attitude. That kind of, think about any person that you have such a kind of attitude in the past 3 months. Please do think about it. This is a live exercise. You can just think about it. No need to share. And absolutely, you know, you will have such kind of a person unless you are a Dalai Lama or unless you are a Pope or unless you are a holy spiritual figure. We are all normal people. We will come about with those people who we are having grudges, revenges, retaliatory attitudes. Think about them. Try to forgive them. We will not be able to forgive them completely, but try to forgive them. That will better our relationship. That will give us inner peace too. Maybe they were thinking something else. They were angry with something else. They were already upset. They were taking it out on you. You may not be able to forget and forgive completely, but when you are able to improve on the positive quotient in your mentality. See, this is not a spiritual exercise or anything. Even though many spiritual people use it, this is a pure management thing. This is a pure management, psychological, empirical understanding of how our mind works. When our positivity increases, that negativity naturally goes down. So think about, forgive a person. Your relationship with that person will be better. He may contribute or she may contribute more positively to you. And your grudge and your other things will go down. Your gratitude will nicely come up. Third, flexibility and adaptability. Please remember, things are not written in stone. Works are not written in absolutely earlier king-like terms. We need to be more flexible, adaptable. That doesn't mean we should be disorderly. That only means we should not be rigid. We should be flexible. The toughest thing in life is to find two words and the real sense in life. Those two great words are having a balance and being optimum. If you are too flexible, you lose order. If you are too rigid, you lose every approachability and positive attitude you have. So how do you balance between being flexible and having a rhythm and an order? Having that flexibility and having that optimum is more of a skill. And if we can go to the last slide, which I consciously left out for a thing, the last slide, no, the slide before. The slide before. Please go back. One more. Yeah, one more. Please remember, emotional intelligence is more of a skill and will than knowledge. Yes, there is theoretical understanding involved. Yes, there is a psychological paradigm involved. Yes, there is a philosophical outlook and insight involved at the same point of time. It is more of a skill and will. And skills are those things you learn by doing it. You don't get to be emotionally intelligent even if you continuously listen to Daniel Goleman himself for 100 lectures. But you listen to it, understand it, assimilate it through your will, make that your skill. That's the only way to go forward. So please remember, emotional intelligence, yes, there is a knowledge aspect, but it's more of skill and will that we should remember. And adaptability and flexibility are more like balance, which we acquire either on swimming or either on a bicycle or either on a stage for public speaking. These are the skills you acquire. You cannot get it from a book. Even though you can understand the concepts from a book, even though you can understand from the lectures, you can clarify doubts. It is at the heart of hearts, skill and will. Now, can we come to the slide which we were dealing with? Yeah. So creativity and productivity increases when you are natural, when you are free, when you are spontaneous, your creativity, your productivity increases. That's a common knowledge we all have. You will have better decision making. You will have inclusive structures in your organization, which will help what Abraham Maslow says, every person to have actualizing his or her own potential in a very positive way. And since it is 6, I'm going to wind up for the larger interaction. Can we go to the next slide, please? Please remember, every idea has a flip side too. Emotional intelligence doesn't mean clever manipulation. There is a huge difference between management and manipulation. And many people misunderstand that. Unfortunately, if you go for a thumb rule, there are many people who try to understand psychology for the reasons of manipulation. Psychology is a science and not magic. And every concept of psychology is understanding, realization, and wisdom and not manipulation. You learn about psychology, emotional intelligence, and such concepts not to manipulate. And please remember that honesty, sincerity is at the heart, at the core, at the soul of everything. Management is not manipulation. A sense of balance we need to achieve between discipline and emotion. Too much emphasis on anything is wrong, whether it be emotional intelligence, whether it be intelligence quotient, whether it be any other quotient or any other psychological concept. Too much emphasis on anything is wrong. We need to have, as earlier said, the optimum levels and the sense of balance we have. And as we conclude, please remember, soft skills are not substitute for hard decisions. But please remember, hard decisions can be better taken and be better implemented with soft skills. The next slide. All this will lead to something that is extremely important in this age. This age, which is having great growth in technology. Every job we know is going to change in the next 5 years or 10 years. Every sphere we know is going to change in the next many years. The only thing that is going to stay strong is the idea of being human, the human element. Everything else is going to be replaced by machines. I'm not saying we'll be something like the Arnold Schwarzenegger movie. I forgot the movie's name. Terminator, Terminator, Rise of Machines. But at the same point of time, the human element, your individuality, your uniqueness is going to be the defining feature of everything. And please remember, like the great social thinker, Mahatma Gandhi or Martin Luther King in the past century pointed out, leadership at some point of time in history meant muscles and power. In the present century, whether it is corporate, whether it is politics, whether it is society, whether it is cultural, whether it is national, whether it is international, leadership at this point of time means getting along well with people, giving positivity, giving energy so that in this very negative field, negative world, in this very de-energized world, you can be light, you can be energy, and you can be a positive beacon who can move the world ahead. And only when you have that inner flame, inner energy, inner positivity, you will be able to radiate that positivity outside. May all such sessions, may all such interactions help you to gain that light, that energy, that positivity, that inner radiance, which will be radiating outside. You wouldn't need to show it or express it. It will radiate from you. I hope you will all have that inner positivity and inner radiance. And I believe we can open our sessions for interactions. I can learn many things from you. I will definitely answer if those things are under inside the domain of my knowledge, else I can definitely refer and get back to you. Thank you. Yeah, please remember this very important aspect. Whatever lecture you hear, whatever session you hear, including from me or even the best people in the world, it is only 25%. The rest 75% is more of interaction and learning. Only when you interact, you learn. You listen to me for 30 minutes. I've presented this thing for 30 minutes. I was thinking, I was reading many books. I was referring to books like this, which are absolute psychology classics. So I could gather many things from the digital media, digital arena. But please remember, from the questions you ask, we learn, you learn, we all learn. I think, you know, thank you for all those kind words. I would be learning more when you can change or you can transform those nice words. Thank you for that, along to questions too. How to overcome anxiety? Very simple thing. First thing, don't resist anxiety. Second thing, realize that anxiety is a very natural feeling which no human being can overcome or totally suppress. You can only manage your anxiety. And please remember, when you manage your anxiety, you can make it excitement. Trust me, this is the transformation, inner transformation you can do. Anxiety is for sure. We are anxious about so many things, but please remember that anxiety can be anxiety in a negative connotation can be changed into excitement when we really can know the transformation or inner transformation tool. So please remember, have that excitement. We are not sure about what is going to happen. So anxiety is very natural. Insecurity is very natural, but that means we are opening up to new things. That means we are open to new things. Please remember that change of perspective will change anxiety into excitement. A long-term doubt, I think it was just messaged privately, so I wouldn't read the name of the person. A long-term doubt on listening skills. When two people are speaking, one is talking too much that he is not giving space for the other to speak. In such cases, how will the other express what he wants to say or what she wants to say? Excellent question. We have all met people in life who talk more. After they're talking, they shut off. They don't even care to listen to us. In psychology, there is a term called catharsis. Catharsis means expressing, you know, it basically means vomiting, you know, in a positive sense. You are throwing out your emotion. You are expressing your anger. You are you are telling and sharing whatever is coming from you. Please remember, the core of expression is a principle that whenever you share sadness, it becomes half. And whenever you share joy, it gets doubled. So yes, you need to have patience in listening skills. You can, in an assertive way, without offending the other person, point out, see, you have really spoken. I really liked it. Many things I really like, I really take it. But I believe you should also listen to my side of the story. Please remember, the most crucial mistake a person makes in communication is not over-talking, but under-talking. The most crucial mistake a person makes in communication is not over talking, but under talking, closing yourself. So the person who wrote to me, from your question, it is almost clear that you are being a person who has always been on the receiving end, where the other person is shouting, arguing too much. Please remember, be assertive, listen to him or her with patience. But please remember, understand that I also have a point to share. Unless you share your point, unless you share your perspective, unless you share your mind, you can never beyond a point listen openly and honestly, because that will be an inside block for you. So please remember, assert yourself, communicate to the other person that you also need to be heard for his own good, for her own good. you want to control your emotions, but not expressing it is also harmful. How to manage? Beautiful question. This is a $1 million question. I think it's again a private question. I wouldn't like to name the person who is writing that. You want to control your emotions, but not expressing it is also harmful. See, this is what Buddha used to call Madhyam Nikaya, or some in rough things, it is called the middle path. See, middle path doesn't mean you don't have an opinion. Middle path doesn't mean you are a vegetable. Middle path doesn't mean you are a fence sitter. Middle path only means you realize that there is an angle, but you realize it need to be positively spoken. It needs to be communicated in a better way. It needs to be always communicated in a controlled, in a managed, in an articulate atmosphere. Please remember, if you were to ask me as a person who studied psychology, management, and philosophy, which is more dangerous? Not expressing at all or expressing too much. Both are bad. But which is more bad or which is worse? Not expressing at all or expressing too much. I would say not expressing at all is more damaging to you, your body, your mind, and your spirit or your core. The reason being, suppressed emotions become a crucial stumbling block, and it creates psychological distance between you and the other person. So please remember, express it in a moderate tone, with a positive intention, with a positivity. Reach out to the other person. Have patience. Take extra time. This is not something that you will learn over a chat, over a question. This is something I can only create a desire in you, a Trishna in you, a kind of understanding in you. You have to do that, and you have to learn that skill when you really deal with the next person. So please remember, next time, assert yourself, express your emotions, but let that not be damaging. Let too much avalanche of expressions or emotions not come. Be moderate, and that's the way ahead. RK, yeah, as we know, communication is important, that is listening skills, how to improve it. Please remember, the core of listening skill is being attentive, being there. That's extremely important. Being there for your colleague, being there for your CEO, being there for somebody. You don't see, unfortunately, in corporate, what happens is after a period of time, you learn to pretend that you are there. You learn to pretend that you are listening. You don't have an honest listening. You don't have open listening. So tell your mind, be honest, be attentive. When you are there, natural solutions, natural things will really emerge. And please remember, listen first and then suggest solutions. Don't suggest solution while they talk. They may be talking, expressing an emotion, conveying a point of view. So that's extremely important too. Which all book you can read? There are many different books that I can really suggest. If you want to have an overview of things, this one particular book is extremely helpful. That is 50 Psychological Classics. It gives you insight about 50 great people, psychological thinkers. You can read Steven Pinker. Steve Pinker is a very good person. Daniel Goleman's book are nice. Or the modern applications, there are people like Edward de Bono. These are all great authors. So, see, right now, the best thing is available is after Fire and Wheel, the greatest discovery mankind had, the greatest creation mankind did is internet. Everything is freely available. Please spend time on internet for such creative and productive things so that you can really go, you can really connect to people, you can really emerge and know. Spending time is the best thing. Internet is the greatest teacher, and it can definitely help you. Yes. Another $1 million question. How to deal with rejection at workplace? The word rejection is a very painful word. Everyone has been rejected by some or the other. You might have been rejected by your ex-girlfriend, ex-boyfriend, your lover, your old CEO, some interviews. Rejection is a part of everyday life. It is very important. We shouldn't fall for rejection. Rather, we take them as occasions of learning and reflections of what is shortcoming in us. Only then we will be able to overcome that. There are many popular examples and folklore motivation tools, urban legends. Perhaps you might have heard something like Amitabh Bachchan was rejected by All India Radio. See, many of these stories are true or half true, but they drive home a larger point. or Sachin Tendulkar wanting to become a bowler, going to Chennai or the then Madras MRF Pace Academy. That's the importance of a place like your family, relatives, your ecosystem, your support system, where Sachin Tendulkar wanted to become a bowler. He went to the MRF Pace Academy with his brother, Ramesh Tendulkar, and he was rejected to become a fast bowler. See what he has become. So rejection is a part of everyday life. Whatever said and done, it feels bad when you feel rejected, when you feel dejected. But at the same point of time, realizing that rejection is a part of everyone's life, it is, we can be able to overcome that. You might have seen Priyadarshan. Priyadarshan is a very famous Malayalam director who has also worked in Hindi movies and all. And he gave an interview 2 days back, which many of you might have read. He said, many new actors rejected me. They don't want to work with me. You might have seen a phase in Amitabh Bachchan's life where I have read Amitabh Bachchan was bankrupt. He was hounded by all the companies. Nobody wanted to be with him. Everybody started rejecting. The brilliant Kaunbanega Karorpati came up. Or I was reading Rajesh Khanna's one interview where Rajesh Khanna said Rajesh Khanna was a bigger sensation. The women used to throw themselves at Rajesh Khanna's feet and they used to write letters in blood to Rajesh Khanna. And one fine day, Rajesh Khanna says, all the letters stop coming. I feel bad. I feel rejected. I feel not wanted anymore. See, this happens to everyone. This happens to all people. Rejections are a part of daily life. Realizing that rejection, realizing that every stumbling block is a stepping stone, is the only way to overcome rejection. Then thank you for all the nice words you are saying. Thank you. Again, a personal question. Our personal problems may have an effect on our behavior at workplace. How do we deal with them? Absolutely. Please remember, even though it is easy to say personal life is personal life and professional life is professional life, in reality, they are intermingled. You had a bad day at office, you naturally take it out on your family. You have a bad day at your home, you naturally get reflected on your work. It is virtually impossible to keep absolutely distant between two different aspects. So it is impossible, but you can always have a clever demarcation. You can always have a clever segregation, but definitely it will spill over. Please remember, it is inevitable. More important, whenever you are faced with a problem, solve it. Don't run away from it. Personal problems are inevitable. I think it was Javed Akhtar Ji whose brilliant lines are, Zindagi ki yahi reet hai, har ke baat hi jeet hai, thodi aansu hai, thodi hasi, aaj gam hai to kal hai khushi. That's the very nature of life. Nothing can be done about it. Like the very nature of seas produce waves, the very nature of life produce waves of highs and lows, ups and downs, goods and bads. See, that's the very nature of life. The thing that gives you happiness gives you sadness. The thing that gives you positivity gives you negativity. That which energizes you, that's you. So that person who has written personal problems, confront it, solve it. If you want, write it down in a book. Have a time period for yourself. Maybe it is a problem with your family, parent, husband, wife, child, brother, sister, uncle, whoever it is. Solve it. And then, or even your colleagues, office, solve it. Better human relationship is medicine. And please remember the next word, the next sentence very carefully. Healthy relationship heal you. It protects your brain. This is not a poet saying. This is Harvard study saying. They really heal you. They protect your brains. So have those personal problems sorted out. Take help. Ask people for help. If you ask 10 people, you will get positivity from 5 people. You may get help from 1 people. Unless you ask, you are never going to get. If you ask, you may not get. But unless you ask, you are never going to get. So take help. Definitely, you will be. Unless you knock, the doors are never going to be open. Courtesy Bible. Rejection, we have dealt, I think, the earlier itself. Which book is best for emotional intelligence? I think you should read the landmark book, Emotional Intelligence by Daniel Goleman itself, because it's written for laymen like us too. We can understand the intimate, in-depth concepts without much complexity. Being neither aggressive or passive, but getting the thumbs over it. Please share a few tips on this. I think Anu Varghese has openly written it, so it's okay, Anu. Anu, brilliant question. Neither aggressive nor passive. That's the optimum we have to find. If you are aggressive, if you are rude, if your tone is bad, you hurt people, offend people, it pokes their ego, provokes them. So naturally, they will feel offended. If you are too passive, you will never get anything of you done. You will definitely feel reluctant, rejected, dejected, feel low, feel less worth, feel everyone is cheating you. The universe doesn't want you. You find a thin line. You find that balance where you don't fall in a bicycle to either your right or your left, either front or back. That's something, Anu, I'll definitely sure you will gain because you have started thinking on this. And please remember, optimum and balance are the crucial word. And always remember, you can never learn swimming by sitting in a chair. You have to be in the swimming pool. So inevitably, trial and error methods will be there. Rejections will be there. Failure will be there. Obvious falling down will be there. Please remember, when we were all children, we all fell down many times before we learned to walk. It is the same with love. It's the same with corporate career. It is same with relationship. The only mistake you can do is to decide that I'm not going to walk, not going to go to swimming pool for the fear of drowning. That's the moment you really drown in your life. Isn't, again, a personal question, which I won't say the name, isn't the personal space invaded when the emotional quotient increases, at least to an extent? See, again, it's a tricky question. See, the personal space is something everyone should respect. But a bit of personal space, when we share with each other, that increases intimacy, bonding, friendship, company, companionship. Yes, it shouldn't be intruded too much, but some amount of personal space when you concede to each other, it gives warmth, it gives some kind of a connectivity between you. So it is rather not invasion. You allow the other person or the other person allows you to share that space where you are comfortable in a particular zone. It can be of many dimensions, but that comfortable space is an absolute prerequisite for having healthy relationship. You cannot be totally aloof from any relationship. So some amount of sacrificing of privacy is extremely important. Communication skills is very important. I think it was Bijulal quoting from some person. Communication skill is very important. How to improve it? Please remember, how much ever you improve communication skills, you can still improve. Please remember these three aspects: words, tones, body language. And in the modern terms, especially written language, WhatsApp text, email text, these are all definite, absolute yes to communication. Please remember, the critical, crucial component of any communication is a beautiful word called respect. You may not be able to like everyone. You may not be able to love everyone. We are not Jesus Christ, or we are not Prophet Muhammad or Buddhas. We may not be able to be compassionate to everyone, but we can always be respectful towards everyone. Please remember that respect is a crucial angle. Have that respect, improve, work, go to seminars, listen to all the internet digital gyan on this, you can definitely improve. If you are hurt with, a personal question, hurt definitely affects your work, absolutely. You should talk it out to your leaders. Please remember, talking is medicine. Talking is medicine. Talking is medicine. Communication heals. So talk it out to them in a very positive manner. Don't shout at them. Don't create more troubles. Share it in a very respectful, share it in a very positive, share it in a very responsible and responding mode. Then only you will be able to do that. How do you connect emotional intelligence with stress in workplace? Trust me, we are all stressed. Especially even work from home, you had to work for 8 hours, 9 hours, sometimes more than what you do in the earlier time. So emotional intelligence is the ability to handle yourself, your stress. Use that stress positively so that you can propel that thing to work. See, there are some people who naturally work well under pressure. There are some people whose style of working is that they can't have stress. Both are okay. There are different types of people. So it is important you learn to deal these things yourself in a positive manner. What I usually suggest is, I personally suggest them to keep a diary, write things down, let that diary be absolutely personal to you. Let nobody else read it. Let no one else know it, but have that, write it down, understand your pain points, realize your pain points. Awareness is half the battle won, action is the other half. Archana Nandakumar asks, has there ever been a time when you felt you need to change your behavior at work? Absolutely, yes. I'll tell you, I'll show you something too that I have emerged. I have huge issues with time management. That's when I learned to use this timer. Right now, every day at work, no, I don't show this to anyone, but I use this timer at work. I time my work. This much amount of time is for this, this much amount of time is for that. And I, because I'm very bad at, because I'm basically a creative person, because I'm more philosophically bent, people of our type, psychometric type, generally give less regard to time. See, this is my core behavior, but I can flex it. I can improve it. I can understand it and I can be better. So my strategy is always keep time. Earlier point of time, I used to speak for a longer period of times where, you know, unconsciously I used to bore people for a lengthier period of time. Even when, well, we are speaking, you might have noticed, right at 30 minutes, I had my time set and I told you, see, I'm going to close. Because I'm aware, I understood time management is a wrong thing or a weakness of mine. I addressed it. I was honest enough to admit it to myself. That's a very important point. Please be honest enough to admit it to yourself and rectify it. Do you know what are the things you should be admitting to yourself? Do you want to know what are the things you want to admit to yourself? Those things really flashed in your mind right now. Just note it down. Later, understand and realize it. You will be able to understand and accept and change. Then, when there are tight deadlines, project to be submitted, limited time, getting along with the people takes a backseat. Yeah, very true, very true. How do we handle such people who prioritize getting things done and don't mind how it is done? Please remember, there are two kinds of relationships we usually have in the world. Relationship with things, relationship with people. Relationship with objects, relationship with human beings. See, whatever said and done, it is impossible to be too humane and too forgiving and too understanding. See, that's not possible. We are all human beings. We also have our anchor. We also want to get things done. You have to strike a balance between dealing with objects and dealing with people. And it is a very tough thing that you really learn. You need to prioritize. You need to follow up. Please remember this golden word. There are different categories of people. That's a different session altogether, which maybe you can explore later. There are different categories of people. Somebody might only want two follow-ups from you to get a job done. Somebody might be wanting five. So you have to be aware about it. And after two times, don't get demotivated. Please tell yourself you are acting for the other person. You are acting because you understand and empathize with the other person. So there's a bigger challenge involved. So understanding people intimately and in depth is definitely yes. How to deal with a person who doesn't understand your point despite you explaining it? Explain more. Be empathetic. Try more. You will get offended. You will get impatient. But there is no other go unless you are ready to disengage from that relationship. There is no other go. Maybe write a letter, write a detailed mail. And unless you have it, you will always create a psychological distance. There are some basic mutual incompatibilities. There are realities of life that can never be bridged. But having said that, almost all differences can be bridged or at least may be improved over a period of time. How to overcome my own feeling from many rejection or failure? I mean, as the folklore, as the urban legend goes, after 99, some people say it is 999, after 99 experiments, Thomas Alva Edison found the right thing for the filament, for the bulb. So, you know, it is said, it is reported that he said, I just discovered 99 or 999 ways not to discover it. It is important that you move on. It is important that you go on. It is important that you stay energetic and positive. Will spirituality help in developing emotional intelligence? Yes, there is a beautiful concept called spiritual quotient, which is emerging in a big way. See, spiritual doesn't mean religious or sectarian or anything divisive. It only means having a deeper sense. In corporates, it is usually called mindful, spiritual, awareness on a different level. Whichever way you want to call it, being connected with yourself will help you to better connected with being connected with others. Being in depth connected to yourself, you will have that better connection to others. How to deal with an employee who is emotionally inconsistent, especially to give feedback, performance review. It's always a big challenge. Always follow a sandwich principle. Give a positive first, give a feedback first, again, give a positive. See, there are some people who can really take feedbacks in a positive sense. There are some people who want inspiration and reinforcement before and after that. So always have a sandwich principle. Start with a positive, acknowledge a positive, suggest an alternative, And third, reassert or inspire or reinforce them with another positive. Follow the sandwich principle. People will take your feedback as tasty as sandwich. You feel alone, aloof, isolated. See, naturally it happens. Whenever we are hurt, whenever we rejected, we close our doors. Please remember, you cannot make air come to you. You can only be open. You cannot make winds blow to your room. You can only open your windows and doors. So have that positive attitude of opening your windows and doors. Air and wind will come on its own. That's the very nature of life. That's the very nature of universe. That universe will definitely shower you with positivity when you are ready to open up after a negativity. Positive working. I think it is Sonia who has again openly asked. Thank you, Geeta. Thank you, Sonia, for the good words. Thank you, Bindu, for the good words. What are the ways to develop positive working environment for the employees? Positive environment is extremely important. Design it first in your mind. Implement it. Understand the peculiarities of your team. They are all different and unique individuals. Only after realizing their uniqueness, you will be able to design this. Please remember, designing a happy environment is extremely important. HR managers can also be happiness managers. HR managers can also act as the happiness ministry of many different nations. We need happy organizations and happy nations so that more creativity and productivity can be there. You feel demotivated. No, I was asking Chetan Bhagat, how do you overcome writer's block? And Chetan Bhagat said, write. That's the only way to overcome writer's block. There is no other way to overcome writer's block rather than to write. There is no way to overcome demotivation than to motivate yourself. The book's name are 50 Psychological Classics, Psychological Great Insights. Then you have Daniel Goleman's Emotional Intelligence. You have the Blank Slate. You have different books, but I think Emotional Intelligence will be doing because that can be used by everyone without much technical jargon. How to deal with people who are jealous of you? Very nice. See, first of all, understand that jealousy is an indirect way of complimenting you. They are looking up to you. They want something you have, they don't have. So understand that jealousy positive thing, be empathetic to them, try to uplift them in a positive thing. That can be, when I am not wrong, but being treated badly by the boss, I am bursting out of tears. How to manage myself during the situation? See, you can take your friend's help. You can confide in a person. You can open up to a person. You can subtly give a positive and assertive feedback to your boss. That's the only way out. Please remember, we all know the way. I think it was Bodhidharma who said a very beautiful thing. I think it is applicable for every human being from every nationality, every profession in the world. Many know the way, but few walk it. Please remember, many know the way, but few walk it. You know the way to go ahead, but you are not walking it. Take that particular courage. Walk it. Is emotional intelligence a skill or a part of character? It's partly both, but it is more of a skill that you acquire rather than a natural attribute you get by genes, heredity, or you know, by birth. It is more of a nurture element. There is nature and nurture element. It is more of a nature element is this. There are some other questions too, but I may be going off. So shall I just go for a conclusion, please?
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
Thank you so much. It was a great honor. It was a real learning session. Thank you for some very good words. Many people have personally messaged. Thank you for that. That shows we all have many questions. Please remember two golden rules. One, please spend time on emotional intelligence. Read about it. Listen to the TED speeches. Listen to what scientists have to say. Information, knowledge is the beginning. Second golden rule, please remember, knowledge alone is not enough. You need skill and will to implement. And how much ever you can learn regarding emotional intelligence, it is not enough. Jitna bhi hum emotional intelligence ke baare mein padhe, wo kam hai. It is usually told in Hindi. The reason being, the more we know, the more we know about ourselves. And I hope such great initiatives and actions from you will help us learn and understand more. And I sincerely appreciate this particular HR forum in organizing things like this. It has been a privilege that I came here. Thank you for all the support you have given me. It was absolutely wonderful. Thank you for Biju. I thank you, Ms. Haripriya. I thank you for the people who coordinated the webinar. They all have done a fabulous job. Thank you for all the arrangements you have done. And Biju, thank you for all the facilitation. It has been very nice. I couldn't answer all the questions, but please remember the core thing is a thirst inside you, an open mind. And I would like to end by saying the most crucial aspect of learning is keep your eyes open, ears open, mind open, and your being open. That openness will help you get wisdom, skill, will, and all the necessary attributes you need in life. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for such an inspiring and informative session. It was great listening to your thoughts, and I'm sure it would help all of us in both professional and a personal way. And I would like to thank all of the participants for such a great participation, and stay safe, guys. Thank you.